Okay, thank you. Hi everyone. Good night. Yeah, hello. Yeah, hello. So how many of you guys are Clojure developer, like writing Clojure full time? No. Okay. How many of you guys do it as a hobby? Yeah. Okay. Most of you. And what? Why everyone else here? Do you just like the name Clojure or something? Why are you here?
I haven't done Clojure, so I just want to.
Okay, nice. Yeah, thank you. Okay, let's get started with the Clojure script for Clojure developer. So I think all of you know what was Clojure, right? Clojure is like a Lisp language that originally working on the JVM, right? The Java Virtual Machine. And then I think on the 2010, maybe, 10, 11 or 12, Rikiki make the Clojure script which compile Clojure to the JSVM, right? To the JavaScript virtual machine that can run on the browser. And today I will show you how Clojure script gonna help you for your project. Yeah. So first of all, I gonna talk about myself. I'm Veha from Thailand. Which is okay, I see. And I'm from Thailand, right? And I'm an admin at the Facebook Clojure group in Thai that have like a 6 member each. And then we have Clojure dinner like a quarterly, like a 3 months. Every 3 months we have maybe 1 or 2 times Clojure dinner, and there show up like a 10 to 15 people. And so they're a really small group of the Clojure in both in Singapore and Thailand, right? So I think how can I add more people in the loop. So I host another functional programming meetup that will join together the Alexa programmer, the MLang programmer, Scala programmer, and make the functional programming meetup called Listen to Function. So I host like a two programming language meetup in Bangkok. So if any of you guys go to Bangkok, you can contact me or go to the meetup and join the conversation at the meetup. And I work at the Smith Thailand for 2 years now. Writing Clojure and Clojure script, I'm full stack developer. So why we want to know about Clojure script? Because JavaScript is everywhere, right? So it on the originally on the front end, right? You can write it on the browser, but now it can running on the back end, on the node. It can running on the cloud, like a serverless stuff. And then somebody from the GitHub, right, make the Electron app that you can make the desktop application on the using JavaScript, right? And also if you want the skipping language, there also some runtime that focus on the permission system called Dino, right? And they also running on the mobile for example the lag native thing. So JavaScript is everywhere. That why your Clojure knowledge may can be used in the front end too, and everywhere too, right? And okay, and actually I want to say the Atwood law. Do you know who is Atwood? He's a programmer who make the Stack Overflow, and he say the rule is that whatever can be written in JavaScript will eventually be written in JavaScript. You can searching for this rule. Yeah, okay, and then the last point is that, but JavaScript is everywhere, but it's not good, right? Why I hate JavaScript, and so should you. For example, the first point is typo alert, right? Do you ever see this meme thing? Like, if you type this on the JavaScript console, let me see what I can do here. Can you see the console now? How about this? Okay. So, for example, if I have the, oh my gosh, okay. Okay. For example, if I type A plus B plus A plus A, it's gonna print the BA and A and A, right? So we have additional NA and A thing from somewhere because the JavaScript type coerce will coerce the plus button here. After the beep, is this pass is like a it will pass the pass button the information before pass button to add other string, right? Add other number, right? But is this number will gonna join with the string, so it return the NAND. So that's why you have the NAND here. Okay, so first of all, the type coerce in JavaScript is really bad. And second of all, they also contain some bad API, such as it. Do you know what is the result of this? Do you want to guess? What happens if I say 10, 10, 10 map pass in? Okay, yeah, no, nobody respond me. Okay. It will return like a 10 NAND and 2. Why? I mean, all JavaScript developers should know, right? That map function is a high order function that accept three parameter, right? The first one is the each value in the in the array, right? And the second one is the array itself, right? And the the second one is the index of each point in the array, and the third one is the whole array itself. So if you put the map into the pass in, the first parameter will always be 10, right? But the second parameter for pass in will be like a 10 and 0. 10 and the first index is 0, right? And it's gonna be 10. But the first index is gonna be NAND, right? It's because first index will be 1, and the 10 base 1 is just NAND, right? You cannot define it. And 10 base 2 will return just 2, something like that, because 1 0 in 2 is return 2, right? Okay, so they make like a bad API there, and there's no way to change it at all, right? Actually, the third one is like JavaScript also have some really bad language design, like a space operation and generator. How many of you use JavaScript in your project? Okay. And do you ever use the generator? Yeah. Do you know why? Because it's not that easy to understand what's going on inside generator. Like maybe you said star function star, and then you need to use things, something like that. And the last of all that relate to Clojure is that JavaScript doesn't have a macro thing. So what happens when your language doesn't have a macro? So you need to waiting for like many years in order to make the language level feature. For example, like a await async, you need to waiting for like a, I don't know, maybe 5 or 7 years, right? In order to make await async available in JavaScript land, right? And now there are always new feature in JavaScript, right? Like a optional chain. Do you know optional chain? They are in the proposal right now, and maybe available to you in 2 or 3 years. That like a, for example, if you want to access nested array, right? Like a a dot b dot c. If you want to access a dot b dot c, and if b is now, so it's gonna alert, right? JavaScript will alert like a b is not defined, something like that. So they're gonna add the optional chain like a. After the variable, they will add the question mark thing. So it's gonna be a question mark dot b question mark in order to make it optional. So no matter how long you have chaining, it not throw the error. So it's gonna be available in maybe a year or so. But if you use Clojure or any language that have macro, you can implement it right now, right? That's the point that I want to make. Okay, but JavaScript is not all that bad, right? Because they are really big user base, right? Before I speaking, I talked to one guy here that they use JavaScript in the project, right? Because there are a lot of user base. So that's a good thing. Yeah, sure. And they also have the first class function. So if you want to, you can make like a functional programming style for your project, right? And it can be really fast if you know how to optimize the project, right? And there also some library like a Google Clojure compiler, and Google use this compiler to compile the Java project to JavaScript, for example, in a Gmail web application. So we know that the JavaScript we're gonna rule the world, right? We're gonna use it will be used everywhere, and we know that JavaScript is not good, but Clojure can be help us in this case, right? And another point that I want to make is that JavaScript, Clojure is a hosted language. It's designed to be hosted language, so it can go anywhere. Like right now, it can be in Clojure, right? Like that compile to the JVM language. Right now, they also have the Clojure script that can compile to JavaScript virtual machine, right? And if you use some linter, Clojure linter nowadays, they also have Joker. That is a Clojure implementation in Golang. Okay, and they also have some Clojure implementation that can be compiled to embedded system coverlet, right? So in the future, I want to make a point that it can work on the platform that gonna become a big thing in the future. Why? Because any Clojure implementation only need 3 or 4 things. They need to have some dynamic loader that can load code to the system, right? They need to have GC in order to manage memory, right? And then user just only need to make the list parser and implement like a 16 special form in Clojure in order to make the whole language work in any programming language environment. So, what I want to, if there are one thing that you come back home today, and I want you to remember only one thing is gonna be Clojure is hosting language that can be porting into any environment. So if you learn Clojure today, I'm pretty sure that you can use it into the future, into the next 10 year, 20 year, into the future. And we can also be able to share the Clojure code, right? In the form called cljc, which means that you're gonna write most of the code into the generic Clojure form that is not depend on any language, right? And you can specific that some function need to be language specific, and you can specific that in this runtime, like in this Clojure runtime, you're gonna run this function. In another Clojure script runtime, you're gonna run another function, something like that. So in this case, you can share your code in both client and the server. For example, in my code, I like both Clojure and Clojure script, right? In our production system, we have validation file that will validate data on both client and the server by using the same code base. Okay, and what next? Number two is that since you already know Clojure, right, and know some functional programming language, you can share this knowledge to the front-end developer. And for the JavaScript interop, I will gonna use the shadow-cljs. And shadow-cljs is a Clojure script build tool that can easily compile Clojure script that have the interop ability to interop with any JavaScript file. So if you already have JavaScript in the project, and if you want to use Clojure script somewhere, anywhere inside your project, you can easily put some Clojure script file there and use Clojure script and use shadow cljs to compile that Clojure script file to the JavaScript file. I will show you next. Okay, and why shadow cljs? So it can, shadow cljs will make the new file, right, called the shadow cljs.edn, which contain the information that have a dependency that come from Clojure and can include the dependency that come from JavaScript world, like using package.json to load module into the node module, and then you can call it. And you can even call the some JavaScript precompiler like a JSX file, and using React component that somebody already load for you. Okay, and I want to make a point that if your app is simple enough, right, it's no different if you're using Clojure or JavaScript. But I mean, if your app is complex enough, so Clojure script is easily the big win because you can write a repo to evaluate part of the system easily, right? And no need to like a building the whole system in order to checking any part of the system. And it can also work on JavaScript framework such as the next.js. And okay, what next? So I want to show you my recommendation frontend stack that I use personally, not in the company. So I use reagent.js, right, for building the UI, and next.js for render frontend side. So why react is the kind of like a reactive functional view. So you declare the view that you want to have, and then just put the data in it, and it will render it will do the rendering optimization, so it's not render all the time. And right now, like this year, React add more and more feature all the time, right? Like do you know hook, React hook, and React suspend, and React add more many feature that I think I'm not gonna use this, and so we can limit scope of the React to just the functional view, and everything else, every interaction view gonna be written in Clojure script part of the system. And then we have Next.js, which is the server-side rendering framework. So if you have the React file and then you want to render anything, you can use Next.js to render it. Okay, so for example, I want to show you some of my code here. Okay. Okay, for example, I have the file here, right, called the dbgam. So this is my side project. What I want to make is something like this. There are project called the dbdiagram.io that they make something like some text that can be able to create this table. For example, if I make a new table called table test, and then make ID, it will gonna generate new table called ID here, right? And then it can have the link between two tables, something like that. So my personal project, I want to make something that look like it with some added more feature. So my project clearly look like here. So at least I have the same editor, and then I have some basic rendering, like it's a table, I call it type, right? and if I have type test, and then I have ID that have type int, it's gonna render the table called test, right, with the ID. So all these things are written in Clojure script, right? So let's looking at the code now. Okay, so right now we have the code here, and it just look like the Clojure code, right? That you have the namespace and some required. The basic, can you see it? Do you see the code now? Okay, this should be better. Okay. So I include some string, right? And some another file, like app.dbgam.parser file. So what I have right here is like a kind of the normal Clojure code, except this require file, right? So normally in Clojure code, you don't require string, right? So you require some symbol, like Clojure.string. And this is like a special parser for shadow-cljs. So in this example, you can include any npm node module file, npm node module inside this file by just using the string name. For example, currently I use the ReactMP code editor. No, I use the code modeler, React code modeler, right? So actually this one is come from npm. Let's see, can I connect to the internet? Okay, nope. So, let's see. I have the project.clj here that contains the React code, the React code modeler tool, right? So I just import this project because I don't want to make my own code editor, right? So I use some npm project and it's super easy. I just do something like npm install React code modeler tool and then use it here. Just like you are using it in Clojure script, in JavaScript, but it's more easy, right? Because we have the repo right here that you can connect your whole code into the system on the browser. Just wait a little bit. Okay, so right now I let's start it again. So right now I have browser here, right? And then if I stop repo here and I make the new repo, I will connect to some repo, right? Okay. And this repo is not browser repo, right? I need to go to the CLJS repo that I gonna require some shadow-cljs dev tool. And then I'm gonna run this command, the shadow-cljs repo command that will connect me to the some shadow-cljs environment. This one called app-dbgam environment, right? So if you're looking at the another file called shadow-cljs, it contains the many build environment like a dbgam environment here. So in this environment, I will connect my system. This environment will gonna start the HTTP server on port 8480, right? And and it can have like a preload some dev tool and have the starting point for the whole module. So we can connect this code to the browser. Like for example, if I send this comment to the browser, like the basic one is +1, right? And then I send this code to the browser, it's gonna return 1, right? So how can I make sure it's connect to the server? We can do something like in the browser you call console.log, right? console.log test. Okay, and the result is here. So you can have the full repo environment that connect to the repo. So right now I have my code here, right? And it come from let's see where it's come from. It's come from the app.dbgam.parser, right? And I'm gonna look at it and I have the table code here. No, not this code. This code, right? Table basic. So if I change the original source code 1 here, like a test int, and I save. Okay, shadow-cljs also have another feature that you can whenever you save anything, it will reload the whole file that you working on and send it to the repo and rerun the whole thing again. So you can do like a reporting by sending command one by one or writing code in the file and save it and it will send the whole file into the repo. And the next thing that I want to show you is the JavaScript interop, right? So right here, I have the file called dbgam.cljs, right? And next to this file, I have file called test.js. And it's like a normal JavaScript file that you can export thing like export default test JavaScript file in test JavaScript file, right? And then if I come back here and I load that test file, test tech file, like I just include it just like the npm include new file, right? So if it in the relative part, you just point it into the relative file, like a ./test, and it will import as the npm other node import feature. So basically you have two modes that you can import code into in the node, right? The default one and is the and the next one is the ask one. So right here we have the function that the text that export as a default, right? So we have the default here that if I already reload it, right? And it will gonna go to here, right? Let me log it out. console.log test file. Okay, it will gonna log the test JavaScript file here. And then if I change anything from this file, like a test.js file in SG and I save it, right? And run this console again, it will gonna using the new version of the JavaScript file. So this way you can include your Clojure script file, right, into the project, into the exit JavaScript project, and then test it with the Clojure report. And the next thing is how about the using Clojure script in JavaScript file, right? So the next thing I want to show you is the whole project here is compiled into JavaScript file, right? So if you looking into the project here, I have function called sort Clojure script, and it will show the all of the compiled code here. So right now I have app.dbgam, right? And it will compile into the app.dbgam.js. And it's gonna be in the in JavaScript format that is not that hard to read. For example, if I looking at my code here, I have a lot of comments, but I have something called code wow, stand for code value, right? That get the data from the parser basic table basic. So if I looking at the code here, I can easily find a variable called code wow, right? You see, it's just the function, it's just the function, it's just a variable in JavaScript project that you can easily use outside the Clojure script because it's normal JavaScript file. Okay, let's go to the next part of the presentation. Okay. And okay, I already showed the demo, right? And I have some tip like if you already use something like GraphQL, we can easily use the GraphQL extension that will help you auto completing and checking the error in the project by using IntelliJ, the same tool that you use in the JavaScript file. And the Clojure editor like Cursive, Cider, Kawa, and on VS Code also support Clojure script, so it can do auto complete and go to definition, and it easily debugging. So because the whole compilation thing is just compiling to the full name, right? So if anything error, you can easily know what is error and where it's come from, At the end of the talk, I think we can and we should reuse Clojure knowledge everywhere, like in Clojure, in Clojure script, or in the future, maybe in the Dart language. And interactive development and functional programming will help you become the better developer. Thank you. That is. Okay, any question? I talk too fast, too slow, or what? Okay, thank you everyone. Thank you. Okay.